Vamos a tener hoy una conferencia impartida por el profesor Andrzej Solecki de la Universidad de Wrocław de Polonia. Él es el director del Departamento de Geología dentro del Instituto de Geología de la Universidad de Wrocław. Imparte su docencia en la Facultad de Ciencias de la Tierra y del Medio Ambiente de dicha universidad. Para hacer un pequeño bagaje de sus trabajos, fundamentalmente ha trabajado en el tema de patrimonio geológico, no solamente en Polonia, sino en muchos países del este, destacando Ucrania. También ha trabajado en temas de minería, especialmente en minas de sal, y en temas relacionados con los aspectos económicos y los riesgos geológicos asociados. En este caso, la conferencia de hoy va a tratar sobre riesgos geológicos que tienen una gran implicación sobre la ordenación del territorio. Sin más, le voy a dar la palabra, voy a hacer la palabra al profesor Andrzej Solecki. Gracias.
Gracias. Buenos días. I continue in English. Unfortunately, my Spanish is very poor. I understand a little bit, but I cannot speak. So today we shall speak about geohazards. Type of geohazards which is connected with earthquakes. Geohazards in general are naturally occurring phenomena which can result in loss of life or damage of infrastructure and buildings. And another term is the risk. Risk is the potential that the exposure to the geohazard will lead to negative consequences such as loss of life or economic loss. To show what is the difference, let's take into account two cases. There is earthquake generating fault in populated region, and people are at risk. And if there is earthquake fault in remote area, there is no risk for people. So hazard is the same in both cases, but the risk is quite different. The same in the case of special codes of building. If there are two towns, A and B, located at the same locality with great earthquake hazard, but town A has quake-resistant building because they have special building code, very restrictive ones, so the risk is there is much lower. But coming back to general earthquake, I would like to tell about two earthquakes which occurred in the past and which influenced strongly the public opinion, the human attitude to the nature, and even to some philosophical questions in the first one, the earthquake of November the 1st, 1755 in Lisbon. So it took place early morning on the day of All Saints in the Catholic Church, when the churches were overcrowded. We don't know what was exactly the magnitude of the quake. We assume that it might be something between 8.5 to 9.0 in Richter magnitude logarithmic scale. Richter scale is logarithmic scale. It means that one step in this scale, it means 32 times increase in amount of energy released in this quake. Two steps is 1,000 times increase. And it describes the energy released in the focus of an earthquake in hypocenter. Lisbon population at the time was about 200,000. The death toll is estimated, and there are various estimates from 10,000 to even 100,000. Because in those years, the statistics were not very accurate. And you must remember that in the case of earthquake victims, there are various kinds of victims. There are people who are killed directly by the shock, directly by a collapsing building. Later on, they may die due to subsequent fire, like in the case of Royal Hospital of All Saints, the largest public hospital at the time, which burned with hundreds of patients. There are also victims of tsunami, which arrived 30 minutes later. And also, they may be victims of lack of food, lack of water, lack of hygiene after destroying of the infrastructure. So it's really very difficult in all, in the case, even nowadays, in case of earthquake, to count who died because of this earthquake. But anyway, 85% of buildings were destroyed, and 4 meter wide fissures opened in the center. So the intensity was high. It can be assumed to be a 9 in Mercalli scale. Intensity is the measure of intensity of shock, of quake, in situ, on the ground surface. It has nothing to do with the energy released during the shock. It has some little bit to do, but not necessary. I will explain it within a few minutes. Here is the scale of intensity. Intensity, it is descriptive scale, where it is told what does it mean. Weak, light, moderate, strong, very strong, severe, violent, and extreme. So in this case of Lisbon, violent, it means that damage great in substantial buildings with partial collapse, building shifted off foundations. So probably this, or maybe even extreme, where some well-built wooden structures are destroyed. Wooden structures generally are very resistant because of the fact that they are very light and they are well bonded together, or this timber construction. But I mentioned that magnitude is not always connected with the intensity. And here's such a sketch. If we have a very shallow earthquake, when the focus of an earthquake is at the shallow zone of our planet, let's say 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 10 kilometers, magnitude may be low, the amount of energy released may be low, but effect on the surface may be tremendous because it's close to the surface. There is no dissipation of energy. But the area of high intensity is relatively small, it is restricted. In the case of deep earthquakes, when the hypocenter is at tens of kilometers of more than 100 kilometers, even in the case of very high magnitude, very high energy release, the effect on the surface may be moderate, even lower than in the case of the previous one. So it will be low intensity, but it may be in the vast area, of course, as you see on the picture. So it looks like this. In the case of Lisbona earthquake, tsunami arrived after 40 minutes, so we can assume that the epicenter was probably under the sea, let's say about 400 kilometers to the west of the coast, because the tsunami needed time to arrive. Tsunami waves travel across oceans at the speed of, let's say, hundreds of kilometers per hour. And seismic waves, which bring the shock, the seismic shocks, they are kilometers per second. So the difference of time of arrival indicates the distance to the epicenter. And here is such a map prepared by a National Geographical Data Center in the States of times of arrival of tsunami waves generated in this in case of this earthquake, and you can see that it can reach the other side of Atlantic within 5 hours and southernmost part of South America within 15 hours, yes? Traveling at the speed of a few hundred kilometers per hour. So epicenter was here, hypocenter deep below, and it exploded somehow here, and tsunami arrived to the coast of Portugal and also to the coast of Spain. A few years ago, I had occasion to observe tsunami marks in Cadiz, where tsunami was at the level of 8 meters above nowadays sea level, medium sea level. What is interesting about tsunamis is that they are very long waves and very flat in an open ocean, but coming ashore, when sea becomes more shallow, the amplitude increase. And there is a moment when the sea retreats at the beginning. It is a very important signal of coming tsunami. Very often, at first, the sea retreats, and later on, it invades the land. Yes, and tsunami was especially effective, let's say, in very bad sense of this world. In the case of the next earthquake of the year 2004 at the Indian Ocean earthquake, which occurred on the 26th of December, second day of Christmas. Epicenter was off the west coast of Sumatra. Magnitude in this case was measured because already seismic stations and seismic observatories existed. It was between 9.1, 9.3, and it was the third largest earthquake ever recorded on seismograph. It has also the longest faulting event, the faulting time, the breaking time along the fracture, which reached almost 10 minutes. Local intensity was of the 9th degree in Mercalli scale. It was violent. And the hypocenter was about 160 kilometers west of coast of northern Sumatra at the depth of 30 kilometers, 30 kilometers deep under the ground surface. The northern section of Sunda megathrust ruptured over a length of 1,300 kilometers, so the rupture was very, very long, and total energy released was 3,600 gigatons of TNT, so it was 550 million times greater than explosion of a bomb in Hiroshima, and 370 times greater than total energy used in the United States in the year 2005. But only a small portion of this energy arrived to the surface of the ground, and it was only 26 megatons of TNT, what is equal 1,500 bombs of Hiroshima, but it is less than so-called Tsar bomb, the strongest bomb ever exploded by Soviets. So-called Tsar bomb, which was energy of it was equivalent of 50 megatons of TNT. I mentioned the rupture, and here is the area after this rupture destroyed the undersea crust, crest, which was elevated. So it resulted in a series of devastating tsunamis along the coast of the Indian Ocean, and the toll of victims is reaching almost 300,000. 300,000 waves were up to 30 meters high. Of course, sometimes tsunami waves are even higher in very specific conditions, but they were very deadly because of few reasons. Coast was overcrowded with tourists from all over the world. It's Christmas season, people prefer to go for holidays and staying at home. And people were not aware what is going on, in fact. And there are no preparations, no tsunami alarms in majority of the area. For example, in States, they have very well developed services which can provide alarm to the public. But it covers the Pacific Ocean mostly, and it was Indian Ocean. So many people didn't realize. And if they were educated, after the first trembling of the ground, they should know that it's better to go away from the sea. After retreating of the sea, it is better to go away and not to go to inside the sea to look what nice creatures are on the bottom, what happened in some cases. The earthquake was so strong that it generated a seismic oscillation of the Earth's surface up to 20, 30 centimeters, what was the equivalent of the effect of the tidal forces caused by sun and moon together. We know that our crust is moving in such a way. The seismic waves, waves of the earthquake were felt across the planet, as far away as the United States of Oklahoma, where a vertical movement of 3 millimeters were recorded. By February 2005, the earthquake effects were still detectable as 20 micrometer complex harmonic oscillation of the Earth's surface, which gradually diminished and merged with the incessant free oscillation of the Earth more than four months after the earthquake. So the Earth was trembling for almost 4 months after this quake. The surface waves traveled all around the globe and concentrated on the antipodal area. They were registered by the station in Ecuador and later on came back to the area of Sumatra. And I mentioned that ocean floor, on the ocean floor, that was 1,500 meter high thrust ridge created by previous geological activity, and it collapsed during this earthquake. And here you can see times of arrival of tsunami waves. And this big rupture, you see here that it break along such a fracture. And tsunami arrived, you see here, at, let's say, 2 hours, 3 hours, and so on. And I have written a report in internet of Polish tourist who stayed somewhere here at the southern tip of Indian subcontinent. He said the day started very bad because at the breakfast there was some trembling of the ground, but we went to the beach and stayed there, and later on tsunami arrived, yes, after 2 hours almost. So there was enough time to inform people, yes, to set up a tsunami alarm. And as about earthquake in Europe, some maps, epicenters, but there are various quakes, not only natural earthquakes, but also quakes connected with mining activity. For example, in the case of Poland here, we have mining-induced earthquake in Lower Silesia and Upper Silesia regions. Lower Silesia is copper mining, Upper Silesia coal mining, yes? But generally, all the Mediterranean zone is full of various earthquakes. And to the west, we can see earthquakes connected with Middle Atlantic Ridge and Iceland there. Here is such a map of seismic hazard in Europe, where there is expected peak ground acceleration as percent of gravity acceleration on the surface of our planet. It may be low, moderate, and high hazard, and it is expected within 50 years. What is especially dangerous with the earthquake? All the buildings are normally designed to withstand vertical pressure, vertical loads. And in the case of earthquake, it's a very significant part are horizontal movements. And normal buildings without special rules are not so resistant to horizontal movements. So what is the origin and mechanism of earthquake and how we can study them? The first, under the stress, rocks break, just break, yes? And let us imagine that we look at a map. It is horizontal plane view from above, and we have two plates, plate A and plate B, north to the up, south to the down, to the left, west, and east, to the right. And where stresses are being accumulated, in some moment there is break along the fault, and these plates move. And black arrows shows compression. The first impulse will be kicking, compression. The white arrow is pulling, tension. And it can be registered in the seismic stations or around this earthquake. We can analyze whether we have first impulse as compression or tension. And we can draw such a circular diagram as in the upper right corner with quadrangles of compression, tension. And we can suspect that here is direction of the main fault or in this direction. Sometimes it's very difficult to specify if we have only one earthquake, to specify which direction is the fault and which direction is the perpendicular plane to the fault. But you see, the network of seismic station was very well developed after the Second World War. Why? Because they were used to monitor A-bomb test underground. In the case of A-bomb test, there is compression in all directions as the first impulse. So it is easy to distinguish them from natural earthquake. But you must have seismic stations in various azimuths from the area which you want to monitor. Yeah? And nowadays, this network is very active, and data about earthquakes are processed electronically almost in real time, almost in real time. I remember a few years ago, I was at an island of Zakynthos, and there was a small earthquake, small, very small, that bang when I entered the toilet, yes? So I went back to my computer, turned it on, and went to the web page of National Earthquake Information Center in the United States, and this earthquake was already there, analyzed, the magnitude, locality, depth of focus, and so on. It goes almost in real time. But in the past, it was not so simple. In China, they developed one of the first seismographs in the world. There is a replica of it. It was such a bronze vessel, diameter of 2 meters, with inert mass inside, and dragons in 8 directions, dragons holding small bronze balls. And when the quake arrived, the inert mass struck the dragon, and the ball fell down. So this instrument showed the direction from which the waves were coming, 8 possible directions, yes? So it was possible in the capital of China, for the emperor of China, to realize that there was earthquake in that province and some relief help should be sent there. And it was used for this. And in some cases, it worked very well. So nobody felt in Beijing any quake, but instrument signalized earthquake, and after 3 days, horsemen arrived that there was earthquake in this area. Yes? But what are the seismic waves? The seismic waves are mostly of two general kinds. One is so-called body waves, and the other surface waves. Body waves are inside our planet, inside the ground, and P waves are such that oscillations are parallel to the direction of propagation of the wave. Oscillations are in the same direction as wave propagation. S waves are in oscillations are perpendicular to the direction of propagation. The P stands for primary, S stands for secondary. Undue prime, undue seconde. It means that P waves are faster and they always arrive as first, is why the P. And surface waves are on the surface of the ground, they are in low waves, which work in horizontal direction mostly, perpendicular to the direction of propagation, and Rayleigh waves, which are in vertical direction, perpendicular to the direction of propagation. And they are slower than S waves, the secondary. The fastest are P waves, I mentioned. Here you have velocity of P wave and S wave inside our planet. So in the crust, the velocity of P wave is of order 6-8 kilometers per second. S waves is 2-4 kilometers. The velocity increases down the mantle because the mantle is more rigid, more massive, more heavy. But in the outer core, which is liquid, S waves do not propagate because there is no possibility of oscillation perpendicular to the direction of propagation. But P waves travel, and it is possible to study the inner core because all what we know about interior of our planet is connected with study of these waves, yes? And as you see, there is a distance, different speed of S and P waves. And for example, in the case of Lorca earthquake, it was registered in Spain, not far away from here, yes, in 2011. It was registered in various stations all over the Spain. And times of arrival, you can see the difference between first P and secondary waves, and it is different, the time lag is different, the greater distance from the epicenter is. So in such a way, sitting in the laboratory and analyzing the time lag between primary and secondary waves, we can say how far away from our station it was. Because if one travels at the speed of 3 kilometers per second and another 6 kilometers per second. It's a simple calculation to study this. And if we have at least three stations, we can draw three circles and locate earthquake on the map, yes, the epicenter area on the map. As I already mentioned, all our knowledge about internal structure of our planet is due to seismic studies. We know that it's outer core, which is liquid, inner core with solid mantle and crust, yes? But according to nowadays view on dynamic processes which are active in our planet, we can speak about the model of so-called plate tectonics, yes? And there are three kinds of plate boundaries in the case of plate tectonics. One, the first one, is the divergent boundary here, where there is a rift and magma penetrating, intruding from the asthenosphere to the lithosphere, push away two plates, two oceanic plates, to the right and to the left, to the east or the west, and it creating a new oceanic crust, yes? But taking into account, here are these plates which were detected due to seismic activity. Here is in mid-Atlantic ridge, which is typical divergent boundary spreading center where plates are moving apart, yes? A new crust is being created. And it's like two great conveyor belts going in the direction of continents, about 2.5 centimeter per year, active for last, let's say, 200 million years, from the south to the north. So opening of the Atlantic started in the southern part and is being completed in the northern part of this ocean. What is interesting, there is record in the of the magnetic field, because basalt, which predominate in these rocks, which crystallize after intrusion, has such a property that it has a lot of iron-bearing minerals and can act like magnetic tape in tape recorder. During crystallization, it records the direction of magnetic field of our planet. And we know that this direction was changing in the past, flip-flop from the north to the south, south to the north. And if it is moving apart, we have symmetric records on both sides of the crest, like in a tape recorder, yes, recorded on this. So it can help us to establish the rate of motion. And rate of motion in the Arctic ridge is less than 2.5 centimeters. East Pacific rise near Easter Island is more than 15 centimeters per year, and so on. Yeah? In some places, this ridge, this rift is visible on the ground surface, especially in Iceland. Well, there is a spreading center between the North American and Eurasian plates, and numerous episodes of riftings are still being observed there, and it is accompanied by volcanic activity. Here is the aerial view of so-called rift valley, which in local language, Nordic language, is called Thingvellir. It means Thing, it was the first parliament of Iceland, and people used to gather in this valley for parliament meetings in open air in this Thing Valley. Fissure zone separating American and European Eurasian plate. It is a view from the north, so to the right is America, to the left is Eurasia. Sometimes we have rifts on the continents. Here, especially interesting so-called triple point, where there are three various rifts meeting Gulf of Aden and Red Sea together, and Eastern African rifts on the continent. Yes, maybe in the future there will be an ocean. Nowadays there are only volcanoes and tectonic lakes there, with such a nice landscape of East African rift. And the other type of boundaries are convergent boundaries. I mentioned that the size of Earth is presumed to be stable during the past 600 million years. In fact, there are some geologists who claim that our planet is being expanded. that expansion prevails, but the mainstream of the science is that the size is more or less stable. So the crust created in the middle ocean ridges must be somewhere consumed, and it is at the convergent boundaries. Convergence is a very slow collision that can occur between an oceanic and larger continental plate, or between two oceanic plates, or between two continental plates. The most distinct phenomena of convergence are within so-called Pacific Ring of Fire. Ring of Fire because there are many volcanoes, many earthquakes, and many of very precious mineral deposits of gold, iron, gold, copper, and silver. You know, all the Latin America, Alaska, California, and the same in Southeastern Asia. And, so this Pacific Ring of Fire, especially in this Peru, Chile area, can be illustrated by pulling down the oceanic crust under lithosphere. And here we have melting of material and nice volcanism. And this volcanism is not basaltic like in the center of ocean, but rather more acid because there are continental crust which is being melted. So volcanism is more explosive, but also more interesting from the mineralogical and mineral deposits point of view. And such nice mountains are created due to it, yes? In the case of Japan, there is ocean-ocean collision. The oceanic plate is subducted under another part of oceanic plate. And here you see the earthquake fossil, very nice located. It is so-called Benioff zone, and it was one of the support proofs of plate tectonics model, yes? That they were located at such a line, a plane, separating these two slabs of lithosphere. And you can see that in some cases, focus of an earthquake may be even at the depth of 200 kilometers. So even if there is a great magnitude, the effect on the surface will be not so strong, but some of them, of course, are in at much more shallow areas. And so it's ocean. Here we have Aleutian Trench, where it's very nice visible here on this map. The depth of earthquake fossil is in various colors. And you see that the deepest earthquake are to the north, the blue, moderate green and yellow, and shallow red, yes? So it's the surface dipping to the north. They are located along this Benioff zone dipping to the north, such an arc here, yes? And continent-continent collision, India and Himalaya. Both plates are relatively light, not so dense, so they are not rather subducted, but overridden, ground is pushed away, high mountains originate, yes? And here we have something like this. And the last important type of boundaries are transform boundaries. When the plates are moving along in horizontal direction, the good example is San Andreas fault zone in California. But something similar is in Turkey, North Anatolian fault, for example. And some Yor faults in Spain are also of transform character. What is dangerous and interesting in the case of transform faults, that epicenters may be very shallow. In the case of subduction zone, they can be very deep. In the case of transform fault, they can be very shallow. In the case of divergent boundaries like rifts, generally there are no high magnitudes. Because you know that resistance to the stress in the case of rock for tension is very low, so it breaks easily in the rift. It's the problem of breaking under compression, and high stresses can accumulate, and large amount of energy can be released. So transform boundaries can have both high magnitude and low depth. Low depth is such a map of earthquakes all around the way. Here in Europe, some areas. A polar view of Europe with nice view of Atlantic Ridge, Middle Atlantic Ridge and Mediterranean zone. You see that Mediterranean zone prolongates to the Himalaya. It's post-Tethys. It's the closure of Tethys Ocean, yes? Collision of African plate and collision of Indian subcontinent. And here is the area of Iberian Peninsula with the, to the left, to the west, we can see Middle Atlantic Ridge and some transform structures which penetrate towards Mediterranean zone. To use our knowledge to protect people, something what geologists can do is to prepare a seismic hazard map, and it is such an example of such a hazard map prepared for United States. Frequency of damaging earthquake shaking around the United States, and this is also a number, expected number of occurrences of damaging earthquake shaking in 10,000 years. So there may be various approaches to this map. What is important in the case of seismic hazard? One is the arrival of seismic wave, and the another is the character of local ground, local basement under the building, because various rocks react in various ways. Here you have some photos of surface effects of an earthquake. It's in the earthquake of October 15, 1979, where there was a fault across the lettuce field, and it shifted lettuce, yes? Just making the work of a farmer more harder, because he has to collect this lettuce later on. Here, shifting of railway track, yeah? Here is from the famous earthquake of San Francisco in 1906, which was followed by a great fire. You see the fence was moved. There is no rupture even visible, but the fence is moved, yes, a few meters. In Poland, we have a small example of a structure which was probably created by earthquake in Ząbkowice Śląskie, Leaning Tower of Ząbkowice, yes? It's local ground response, probably differential subsidence of the ground. Differential subsidence, local ground response is very, very important. For example, earthquake and slumping, because there were good conditions for slumping, and earthquake triggered slumped in the area, devastating cause. So Jesus told to St. Peter, you, Peter, are the rock, and on the rock I will construct my church, yes? Yes, in seismic zone, it's better to construct anything on the hard rock, not on the soft sediments, yes? It's one of the principles of seismic engineering. Here, slumping, and only some rail tracks were left. And very interesting phenomenon is called liquefaction. Liquefaction of soft water saturated fine-grained sediments, like lake sediment or bay sediment, lagoons, and so on. They are full of water. The seismic waves, when arrive, their amplitude rise very strongly in the soft ground. So the energy is left in this. And everything starts trembling, and the water and sand becomes liquid, and it can erupt violently through the cracks. And in geological records, sometimes in old rocks, we can see so-called Neptunic dikes, which are traces of such events in the past, in the sedimentary record. Such a crater after such an eruption, water and sand eruption. And it is very dangerous because here you have very nice blocks of flats, well constructed, it is in Japan. So they have probably very restrictive building code, yes? So building just fall down, but not collapse, but fall down because of the liquefaction and differential subsidence. And here is a very nice example. To the left part of this building, the ground was more stable, maybe sand, coarse sand, gravel, or bedrock, and to the right, probably some soft sediment with water, and it due to liquefaction, such subsidence, yes? And some remarks about the terremoto de Lorca, earthquake of Lorca in 2011, which occurred at the Alhama de Murcia fault. The terremoto took place here. And you see there are two faults. One fault is coming here from the Atlantic Ocean along the Betics. And here is the Alhama de Murcia fault. And it was carefully studied by Spanish and abroad teams. And it is very interesting because magnitude was very low. Magnitude 4.5, it's almost nothing. It's very, very low energy. But it was the foreshock. Later on, the main shock was 5.1. It's not so, also not much, but it was extremely shallow. First estimates were 1 kilometer. 1 or maybe 2, 3 kilometers later on they claimed. But the intensity was 7 on the Mercalli scale, but in very limited area, in very limited area of Lorca. At least 8 light aftershocks were detected or felt by people, but in fact by instruments there were many more of them. 9 people died and dozens were injured, and there was a damage to Esperon Tower or Lorca Castle, the Hermitage of San Clemente, and the Convent of Virgen de las Huertas. It was the worst earthquake to hit the region since 5 magnitude earthquake of Albolote, 1956, and it was direct result of strike slip at Alhama de Murcia fault, which is 40-50 kilometers long. And some signs of surface rupturing were visible in the vicinity of the fault. So it was a reactivation of small section of this fault. The great damage may be explained by the southwestward directivity of shallow rupture that induced high acceleration values in Lorca village. Similar earthquakes in Lorca were described in 16th and 17th centuries. But due to archaeological studies, they found that there were also stronger earthquakes, possible of magnitude 6, during the last 10,000 years there. But according to some studies, the pattern of earth movement was consistent with changes in stress caused by removal of water from underground reservoir. Because in the Lorca area, there is intensive exploitation of underground water, and the ground deformation is regarded to be one of the highest in Europe, about 10 centimeters per year. And it is commonly known phenomenon that changes in ground load, for example, extracting the water or filling the artificial water reservoir, can trigger an earthquake. It does not mean that it is the reason of an earthquake. The earthquake was going to be, the stresses were accumulated, the earthquake was in preparation, but human activities just triggered it. Yes, and possible this removal of water resulted in the fact that it occurred just in this very moment. Here is such a nice view of the area with Lorca here and Gadrin Basin. And the quake was felt along the Mediterranean coast in Murcia up to Valencia, more than 200 kilometers away. Yes, here is the map which I showed already to you. And here are the faults and historical earthquake southwest of Murcia and to Lorca here. And here, very interesting is this group of this cluster of very, very weak earthquake. I am not an expert in your territory, but I do suspect that maybe there the water is being subtracted of some mining activity, which can result, but because it looks very curious there. Northwest of Lorca, yes? According to such a line, because I've told you that the main interpretation is that this is the fault responsible for an earthquake. Here you have these diagrams which show the movements according to registration of various stations, but some aftershocks were southwest of the main Lorca quake. So in that direction, together with the previous one, yes, it looks quite interesting. So maybe there is some perpendicular fault also involved in this. Here is the map which I generated from the US governmental page, many earthquakes in this area. Here is Lorca. So maybe it was not Alhama de Murcia fault, but maybe something also perpendicular to this direction acted in this time. It is Alhama de Murcia fault. Here is time of and number of shocks, the first shock, fourth shock, main shock, and some aftershocks. You see much more than 8 of them. It is according to the report of Instituto Geologico e Minero de España and Ministro de Ciencia e Innovación. Yes. And in this report, there are also nice examples of surface effect, block collapse, destroying buildings. And they measured also the temperature of hot springs associated with Alhama de Murcia fault, but there was no change in temperature of water. It is very interesting that you have springs along this fault because observation of springs can give a forecast for an earthquake. Because during preparation of earthquake, when the stresses are accumulated, there are changes in pore volume. And some waters and some fluids, gases, can be pressed out. And the level, the temperature, the radon content of water can change and can be a good signal for coming earthquake. Here there is a figure of way in which archaeologists studied the effect, fault scarps, landslides, rockfall, and so on, and they discovered that there were many earthquakes in this area, sometimes even more, even stronger than the last one. And the primary conclusion of the team mentioned here of this Spanish report was that Alhama de Murcia fault is a fault with greater evidence of quaternary activity in the area, with evidence of paleoseismic activity magnitude higher than 6 over the last 1,000 years. It is associated with thermal springs. The high seismic intensity experienced by town of Lorca, intensity 7, is maybe due to the earthquake, to the fact that the earthquake spread from the Sierra de Tercia epicentral area to the southwest. The lack of geological effects toward the east of the epicenter supports the possible directionality of the propagation. The wave propagation supports the directionality of the rupture that spread from the epicentral area crossing the city of Lorca. Fellow earthquake would explain the high seismic intensity. And this is interesting and important, and it is reasonable, that increasing in static stresses on the segment of the Alhama Murcia fault generated by the main earthquake may have increased the likelihood of earthquake occurrence in this area. So if we have one big fault and earthquake occurred at some segment of it, we can expect that in the segment where they did not occur, they will occur. There is so-called seismic gap theory, because the stresses were released here and all the stresses are concentrated in the area where there was no earthquake. So it would be reasonable to observe Alhama de Murcia fault, especially the places where there was no earthquake, because in the Lorca it was already was, the stresses are relieved, but in other places now they are accumulated even in stronger way. Archaeoseismology helped a lot, and it generally improved the knowledge. So there were conclusion of the Spanish team from this report, and conclusion of this earthquake. We are coming to the end of this lecture. We are coming to the end. First, earthquake release much more energy than any man-made bombs, million times more sometimes, yes? If explosion is shallow, effects is significant, but in limited area. We cannot predict the exact time of quake, but we can provoke it by pumping and so on, pumping water out or pressing water down. We can specify areas of high seismic hazard, taking into account the possible seismic waves arrival and the local ground response. So it is desirable to prepare maps of an area for geoengineering and building construction, what kind of basement rock we have in this very place, whether they are hard rock, resistant to the shock, where the amplitude of waves is low, or they are soft sediments saturated with water. There was such an earthquake in Mexico, I think, 20 years ago, where epicenter was in close to the coast, but the greatest disaster was in the capital of Mexico, because you probably remember that it is on the lake. There was a lake in the times of first conquistadors. Yes? So they're very soft sediments with tall buildings trembling, and the greatest number of victims, the greatest seismic risk was there. Yes. We can introduce restrictive building codes and proper land management. It's very important for land management to avoid the area with soft sediment, to avoid the area with hanging rocks which can fall down after the quakes. And what is important, we should prepare emergency services for tsunami alarm, fire brigades, water and food supply, medical care to reduce the epidemic risk. One of my colleagues told me that majority of people die because of cold and not because of the earthquake. For example, if in the mountains of Afghanistan you have earthquake in a cold season, everything is destroyed, people are afraid coming back to homes, most of them die because of pneumonia, and not, but they are earthquake victims, yes? So just after the quake, we must be able to react in a proper way. And of course, we should educate public how to react in the case of earthquake. Just don't wait for tsunami. In the case of quake in the building, you should hide in the corner or under the frame or under the table because something may fall down and so on. There are very detailed instructions, especially in the United States. What do they recommend? To have some food, water at home, gun to protect yourself, and coins, because the bank machines would not be working, yes? Food, gun, and water, yes? We should educate the public how to react in the case of earthquake. So thank you very much for your attention.